We'll be talking about that a little bit this morning. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians. We're going through this letter, Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, under the overarching theme, the perfect gospel for an imperfect church. Spurgeon also said the Bible is like a lion. You don't have to defend it. Just turn it loose. It'll defend itself. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, we're looking at verses 6 to 16. If you've been tracking with us here, you know that Paul has been talking about the wisdom of God contrasted with the wisdom of the world. He's doing this in the larger concern over divisions that are in the church at Corinth. And he's headed somewhere with this, and you're going to see it full-blown in chapter 3. And so today, as he continues to make his argument, he's talking about the mystery of the wisdom of God. It's not apparent. It's not obvious, as Joshua referenced. People today, so-called intelligent people, who have more degrees than a thermometer, think the Bible is foolishness. Paul has a different take on it. Let's stand together. I want you to follow along with me as I read 1 Corinthians 2, 6 through 16. If you don't have your Bible with you or don't have a Bible, we've got the text on the screen for you. And then see me after the service. We want to give you a Bible. Paul says, "Yet among the mature we do impart wisdom, although it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to pass away. But we impart a secret and hidden wisdom of God, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except the spirit of that person, which is in him? So also no one comprehends the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given us by God. And we impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. The spiritual person judges all things, but is himself to be judged by no one. For who has understood the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." What have we just read together? We read the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient Word of God. May the Lord further illumine us here today, those of us who know him as our Lord and Savior. And my prayer is that those who have not yet become Christ followers will have their eyes opened to see the glory of the mystery of the wisdom of God in Christ. Thank you. Please be seated. Paul is concerned, as he pens this portion of his letter, that the Corinthians in that church, who came out of that Corinthian culture, we've already described it to you previously, who would have been fascinated with Greek philosophy, that they're bringing that into the church. They're making wisdom, the measure of the wisdom of the gospel, they're measuring it by the wisdom of the philosophers of their day, the wisdom of the world. In fact, we're going to read in this text a little later where it appears that perhaps they have used that on Paul and have said, Paul's not a very articulate man. He's not a very wise man. He doesn't follow the strictures that we have been taught as a way to understand truth and reality. And so I want us to see, as we unpack this passage today, six things. This wisdom that we impart that he mentions in verses 6 and 7, and we recognize that it's a wisdom that's not understood naturally. It's a wisdom that's not anticipated. It's a wisdom really beyond comprehension. But it is a wisdom revealed by the Spirit. It takes revelation. And then finally, the difference between the natural and the spiritual person. First of all, let's look at this idea, this wisdom that we impart. He says this in verses 6 and 7. Yet among the mature, and that word there, mature, can speak of complete. It's even a word sometimes used as perfect. And what he's talking about there is a level of growth, which we know can happen in short order because he's writing back not that many years after he's been there and labored there. People who have grown to love and appreciate the truth that they've been given concerning Jesus Christ. These are out of a Greek culture, remember. They would have not grown up in a Jewish setting, exposed to the Tanakh, to the Holy Scriptures of the Old Testament. Among the mature, we do impart wisdom. Although it's not a wisdom of this age, or of the rulers of this age, who are doomed to pass away, but we impart a secret and hidden wisdom of God, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. He's not here talking about an elite group of Christians, super spiritual Christians. He's talking about normative, growing Christianity. He's going to emphasize that a little later in chapter 3. Normative. If you are growing as a follower of Jesus Christ, if you're reading his word, if you're practicing the spiritual disciplines, feeding upon the word, learning, as we're talking about in our challenges to one another, learning to listen to the Spirit, to meditate upon the truth that you've been taught, to hear him, learning to be more and more like the Lord Jesus Christ, growing as a person of prayer, witnessing, fellowshipping, all these spokes that go into the wheel of growing as a disciple. If that's happening in your life, then you are maturing and the Word of God is becoming more precious to you, not less important to you. So Paul talks about that. He says in Philippians 3:15 something similar, let those of us who are mature think this way. You see, maturing as a Christian affects your thoughts. And then he gives this challenge. And if in anything you think otherwise, in other words, he says, if you differ with what I've taught you, and the church at Philippi was a church he deeply loved, if you differ with what I've taught you, if you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. In other words, if you're not where you should be, if you're growing, you will get there. That's the challenge. And it's a warning against being stifled and stymied as a believer, thinking you've reached a point where you don't need the disciplines. We need the spiritual disciplines until the Lord takes us home to glory. And then discipline will come in a glorified way for us, but a very different way. So understand here that mature would be equivalent to spiritual. If you're spiritually minded and cultivating that spiritual mindset, and there are some things you begin to see the wisdom. We do impart this wisdom, he says. He says, this wisdom we impart is Christ crucified. It's the gospel. It's the mystery. He tells us in verse 7, we impart a secret and hidden wisdom of God, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. What did he decree before the ages for our glory? What is the covenant of redemption we've talked to you about through the years? It's the eternal covenant. It's what Hebrews talks about, the blood of the everlasting covenant, the eternal covenant of redemption. Is that time before time, if I can say that, where the Father set his heart on a people to save, and the Son pledged to come in the fullness of time and live the perfect life that sinners are commanded to live but do not, in the fullness of time to die in the place of sinners, hanging on the cross, taking our sin upon himself, enduring the wrath of God for sin, satisfying divine justice by suffering and dying in our place, then rising from the grave 3 days later. The Holy Spirit committed in that eternal covenant to come in the fullness of time, sent by the Father and the Son, to apply the gospel, to make it effectual, to open blinded eyes, open deaf ears, raise spiritually dead people to life, set the enslaved free in the gospel. He committed to do that. And Paul is talking about this mystery. No one would have figured that out, folks. You could have put the brightest minds in the world together and said, come up with a plan to rescue humanity. And whatever it was, it would not have come close to God's plan of redemption. No one would have considered that God would lay the burden of sin on his son, execute his son in the place of sinners, his darling son, his sinless son. And having done that, no one would have anticipated that he would have raised him from the dead 3 days later. The gospel is a mystery. We said at the outset, Paul said it earlier, it is foolishness to Greeks. It is a stumbling block to Jews because it doesn't fit the Jewish mentality. But it is the mystery of God revealed in ages past. Paul said this as he was closing out the book of Romans in chapter 16, verse 25. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages. Preaching, writing there to that Roman culture. Again, not a natively Jewish culture, though they had some Jews in the congregation at Rome. Primarily a Greek culture. This mystery is key. The truth has been clearly revealed to all who have the Spirit. The mystery, the word mystery, by the way, it's one of those words in the Greek text that's not translated. When we read mystery, we're not reading a translation of the Greek word. We're reading a transliteration. The word in the Greek is mysterion. Mysterion. So it comes to us as mystery. Just, it's anglicized, if you please. It is something partially hidden in the Old Testament that is revealed in the New Testament as an end-time reality. The Puritans had a saying, the new, meaning Testament, is in the old concealed. The old is by the new revealed. God's plan has never changed. It's always been the same. It's just been enlightened, illumined, like the man striking the match in the Stygian dark cave and then touching it to the torch, and more light comes on, and he begins to, things in the cave begin to take shape, not because they've been brought in as he's illumined it, but because they were there all the time, and more light gave a clearer picture of what was already there. Paul speaks about the Lord of glory. They wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory. The rulers of this age, which he includes, by the way, he includes the Jewish leaders in that, didn't understand the mystery. They taught the Old Testament. Pharisees memorized the Old Testament. And they didn't understand the mystery. Now, why is that? We're going to see here that the only way you understand the mystery of God, hear me now, is when it is revealed to you or illumined to you by the Holy Spirit. It's supernatural. Whether a 6-year-old child or a 96-year-old adult, it takes a supernatural work of the Spirit to open eyes to the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ and his goodness shown to us in the gospel of his grace. That's why you shouldn't get frustrated, by the way, when you witness. When you just honestly share the gospel. You shouldn't get frustrated if someone looks at you like a tree full of owls or dismisses it as nonsense. Or why? Because it's supernaturally revealed. You weren't saved because you figured it out. You were saved because the Spirit of God opened your mind and your heart to the truth of it. Paul preached, remember, by the river. Lydia was a God-fearer there. Remember that? What are we told? And the Lord opened her heart to receive the things that Paul was teaching. And so we've got to embrace this. Paul says in Romans 8, 29 and 30, as he says in our text, talking about this having been decreed from ages past. Romans 8, 29 and 30, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Those whom he foreknew. There's this picture here. Before time, God setting in motion. Paul picks it up in Ephesians 1:5. He predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. Do you realize if you're saved here today, you were not saved accidentally? If you're saved here today, you were saved on purpose. And guess what? That applies to anyone else who will be saved in here. God saves on purpose. He's not a hit and miss God. He's not a try his best God. He does it, and he does it well. We have good news to share, and we all have a great purpose to share it. Look at secondly, at this wisdom that's not understood. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. They just didn't get it. They didn't get it. It's interesting. They read it, memorized it, they taught it, if they were Jews. They mocked it. They scorned it if they were Gentiles. But Paul says the best evidence that you have that the mystery of God's wisdom was not made known to them is that Jewish leaders conspired to hand over the Son of God to Gentile leaders, the Romans, who willingly took him and executed him. He said that is impossible to happen if their eyes were opened. They would not have done it. But the fact that they did it meant they didn't understand. They never would have figured it out on their own. Neither were any of you. Neither were anyone you're sharing the gospel with. Neither were anyone you're praying for. I may sound like bad news, but that's wonderful, glorious news. Because that means if God comes to them by the Spirit, you just share the gospel. You give them the scriptures. You pray that God will open their hearts. And he's able to do that. Jesus said when he was hanging on the cross, remember, Luke 23:34, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And that was true. They know not what they do. Well, he taught in Acts 20, verse 28, and he challenged those who were leaders in the church at Ephesus, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. They meant to exterminate him. The Jewish leaders thought when they handed him over, this would finish him. The Romans thought when they crucified him, put him to death, that'd be the end of this insurrectionist. That'd be the end of this guy going around stirring up trouble, claiming to be a king, letting people praise him. You studied in Sunday school this morning the triumphal entry, where they hailed him as a king. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The Jewish leaders and the Roman leaders thought they would silence him. Paul taught later on. It was when his blood was spilt. He purchased the church with his own blood. Third, I want you to see this wisdom not anticipated. Verses 9 and 10, but as it's written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. It's a citation from Isaiah 64:4. He says, these things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. Now, it's important to start thinking about three words: inspiration, revelation, and illumination. And don't confuse them. Inspiration tells us the authority of the Scripture. We'll read in a moment 2 Timothy 3:16, which you know well. All Scripture is inspired. The word inspired is literally God-breathed, theanoustos. All Scripture is breathed by God. This book does not simply contain the Word of God. This book is the Word of God. Every word of it breathed out by God. That is inspiration. We use the word, well, I was inspired to write this poem. And we know what we're saying, but what we're not saying is that God breathed upon me this poem. No. God breathes into our first parents the breath of life, and Adam becomes a living soul, and he then takes Eve out of Adam's side. And he breathes this word. Inspiration. Uniquely sourced in God. Uniquely for his special purpose. There's revelation, though. We read it in Ephesians 3 a while ago. We talked about this was revealed to me. Sometimes you hear people speak of the Bible as the revelation of God. They're not talking about the book of the revelation, the Bible. And it is revealed. Paul wrote, the writers wrote, the prophets wrote. In fact, let's read these passages. Look at 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness. And then Peter said it this way, 2 Peter 1:20 and 21. Knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried, borne along by the Holy Spirit. Men didn't make it up. They didn't make it up. J.I. Packer, we've given many of you copies of the Reformation Study Bible, and one of the strengths of that great study Bible is the theological notes that are in it, and they were written by the esteemed theologian J.I. Packer. He has a section in there on what he calls the illumination of the Holy Spirit. You see, there's inspiration, then there's revelation. God led Paul to write. He led Peter to write. He led all the prophets to write. Every word. We're studying on Sunday nights. We're looking at the summaries of every book of the Bible. And everything we're looking at is what God led these authors, whether we know the authors or not, led them to write down his revelation, what he is revealing. History, someone said, is his story. God's word is his story. Revelation reveals something of him, reveals everything of him we need to know for life and godliness. People misuse the words. I say, well, I had a revelation the other day. I'm not, sometimes, depending on the mood I'm in, if I have a Bible handy, God revealed this to me, and I'll say, well, you got a pen? I've got a little blank space in the back of my Bible here that you might want to go ahead and put that down. That's revelation. Now, what happens to us is illumination. When you were saved, the light of the gospel was being preached. You've been reading it. You'd heard it in some way, shape, or form. The revelation of God was put before you, which is final, by the way. The Bible is the complete revelation of God. And in a way that had not happened to you before, when you crossed from death to life, your eyes were opened. Your heart was opened. John Wesley said, my heart became strangely warmed. We sing that great hymn, and can it be my long my imprisoned spirit lay fast bound in sin and nature's night. Mine eyes diffused a quickening, thine eyes diffused a quickening ray. I rose, the dungeon flame with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose, went forth, and followed thee. That's the illuminating work of the Spirit in saving you. When you were saved, the gospel light, which had been shined in your eyes, maybe by faithful people for years, was attended by the Holy Spirit opening your blind eyes. If you took a flashlight and shined it in the eyes of a blind person and said, can you see? Can't you see? They tell you no. If you kept shining it, and all of a sudden the person said, I think I see something. Something's happening there. Illumination. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. So think about it, folks. Now as we've been saved, you're growing in grace. you've discovered some things. Maybe in Sunday school this morning, the Lord put together some verses that your teacher was teaching you, and you had not seen them that way before. That's illumination. More and more light. Gospel light attached and attended by the Holy Spirit giving you more light, opening your eyes increasingly to see the truth as it is in Jesus. That's what's going on. So remember that. This is a little lesson. Smile when someone tells you that God revealed something to them and just say, I know what they're saying. What they should have said was illumined. Run from those who insist, no, it is a revelation. God revealed this to me because he's finished his revelation right here. It's no more there. He's illumining people to it all the time. Such a glorious God he is. And so we see this searching of the Spirit in our lives. Psalm 139:1 says, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. Paul says it differently in Romans 8:27. He who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. There's this great mystery. You see, we pray to Jesus and we bear our heart to Jesus in petitions, not because he needs to know. In fact, he knows what we have need of before we ask. But we do this in prayer as a way to commune with him and fellowship with him, to show our utter dependence upon him. But John 2:25 tells us about Jesus. He needed no one to bear witness about man. He doesn't need you or me to tell him about somebody, for he himself knew what was in man. He knows the hearts of men. The next thing we see in this wisdom is it's a wisdom beyond comprehension. Paul asks the question, who knows a person's thoughts except the spirit of that person which is in him? So also no one comprehends the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. It's interesting, we think we know one another. Karen and I have been married 41 years. Right? 42 years? 42 years. Be 43 in June if she keeps me after that comment. And I can tell you I know her as well as anybody knows her, and she knows me as well as anybody knows me. But you know what? I don't know her as well as she knows her because I don't know her thoughts. That's what Paul's saying here. Who knows a person's thoughts except the spirit of that person which is in him? So also, no one comprehends the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. Again, I go back. Isaiah said, as high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are the thoughts of God from our thoughts. His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. We would never figure him out. In fact, I'm going to say, any God you've figured out is not a God worth following. And the beauty is that God, look at the love of God here. God could have simply revealed himself to us in nature, which Paul says in Romans 1, that there's no one who can be excused, not in the deepest, darkest jungles of any place on the planet, because there's enough of God revealed in the nature around him to convince him or her that there is someone or something bigger than themselves out there that they're responsible to. And God could have simply revealed through natural revelation himself and condemned us all justly. Herein is the love of God, that he didn't leave us there, that he came with special revelation, that he sent the prophets speaking his revelation. He had writers write down his story. He sent the apostles preaching the gospel. He had writers write down his story. You see, isn't it wonderful that what we're talking about today was not left to original oratory? That if you didn't hear it from those mouthpieces, you missed your opportunity. No, it was written down in a book. It's written down in a book. Revelation of God right here, kept for us through the ages. And we can read this and be confronted with the mind of God, with the heart of God, with the plan of God. But even that, it takes the Spirit of God to take what God has revealed in here to illumine us so that it comes to be meaningful for us. That's why you've known people. who read the Bible, read the Bible, and they become bitter, angry, complacent, whatever the attitude they manifest. That's all that happens when you encounter God's truth that way without the attending work of the Spirit to make it precious to us. And that's why Paul goes on and says this was wisdom revealed by the Spirit. Look at verses 12 and 13. Now, this is true, but now we have received not the spirit of the world, which the Corinthians were using as their standard for how they were acting, misbehaving, and then they were using it as a standard to judge Paul. We'll see this in a minute. We've not received the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given us by God. God didn't make us earn them. He didn't make us qualify for receiving them. We didn't have to reach a certain level of expertise, a certain moral capacity. He freely, without cost, has given us these things. And we impart this in words, not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit. Paul's talking about the revelation that he has been granted. He preaches that which the Spirit has revealed, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. And here's where it comes down. I realize that anytime I preach, and there's a dullness to my preaching probably, but I realize that there are people, I could be the most exciting, dynamic speaker in the world, and some people will find that dull and not useful. But I also realize that the spiritual communication, the illumination of the truth that I'm telling you, to spiritual people, it's truth. To my shame, I tell you that when I was a teenager, in my Sunday school class, I remember Jerry and Beth, the couple that taught our youth. Jerry and Beth Ingram, I think was their name. And I would ask him things in class, like, how do you know that's true? I mean, really, who are you to say to us that you found the truth? I mean, don't we have some say in this? I mean, I'm telling you this shamefully. And he bore with me patiently. And God didn't strike me dead in Sunday school to teach those other young people around me, don't get this way. But he illumined me. And what Jerry and Beth Ann were teaching us became sweet and precious to me in time. Because I promise you, if you look back then, folks would have said, someone said, you know, he's going to be a preacher. They said, there's no way he's going to be a preacher. Not in this life. The sweetness when God makes it known. When he reveals those truths that are obnoxious to the natural person, that are easily dismissed to the unconverted person, but to those who are spiritual, they're sweet, precious promises, principles, lessons, examples. Paul says, we impart these words. Well, we need to wrap this up. The difference between the natural and spiritual person, verses 14 to 16. He says the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. Now here's, the natural person is the person who's not been illumined. They're still in darkness. They can read, they can hear, they can sit right next to you, they can open their mouths and responsibly read the Scripture, but they don't accept them. They're foolish to them, really. Now, they may not be just rail against them, but they're foolish to the extent that they have not found them worth following, have not found them worth embracing, have not found them worth letting them shape their lives. They're folly to him, and he is not able. Here's the deal. The natural person will not and cannot because they are spiritually discerned. When you pray for people that you know who are unconverted, you never pray, now Lord, he's a pretty smart fellow, and I just wish that he would use his intelligence to sort all this out and see how important. No, you don't pray that, do you? Dear God, open Bob's eyes. Dear God, convince him of the truth. Show him he is a sinner. What are you praying? You're praying for God to do what only God can do, and that is to bring spiritual discernment to a person, that he might pass from death to life, that he might go from being not a Christ follower to becoming a Christ follower. The spiritual person judges all things but is himself to be judged by no one. I think this is where Paul is taking a dig at the Corinthians who were judging him with their Greek philosophies. The spiritual person has a judgmental discernment. He's able to, you know, people say, well, Matthew 7 says, judge not, lest you be judged. For what judgment you judge, you shall be judged. That's not what he's teaching there. Because in Luke's gospel, Jesus says, stop judging by outward appearances and make a right judgment or a righteous judgment. Spiritual people should not be judgmental, but every day you make judgments. Is this what I'm hearing today? Is what I'm hearing today, is it reflective of the truth of Scripture, or is this fellow making it up? It's what I heard at work. It's what I'm hearing on the radio. It's what I'm hearing on TV. It's what I'm reading. Is this true? We have to be discerning. And spiritual people who are growing in grace, using the disciplines, are growing in their capacity to discern the things around us and to discern in our own lives what is sin, what is not. You grow in that. You grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he says, for who has understood the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? The judgmental spirit happening in Corinth is unbecoming of a church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul's basically saying you can't take the worldly wisdom that you have and superimpose it upon the way of God. You can't do it. And your goal ought to be, and my goal ought to be, that we can say we have the mind of Christ. Paul said to the church at Philippi, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That's the goal. And guess what, brothers and sisters? As I seek to have the mind of Christ, and as you seek to have the mind of Christ, do you know one thing that will not and cannot happen? We will not be squabbling with one another. We will not be at disunity. Each of us seeking the mind of Christ will draw us nearer and nearer. It's the same kind of pyramid that you show to a young couple when they're first married. Here she is, here he is. Here's the top of the pyramid, and you tell them the closer you grow to God in your relationship, the closer you will be with one another. It's the same mentality. The more I seek the mind of Christ, the more you seek the mind of Christ, the more we seek for biblical wisdom to dictate to us what is true, to shape our thoughts, to shape our wills, to harness our desires and filter them, the more each of us does that, the more we will draw nearer to God and to one another and be a people of one mind, one purpose. That's what Paul wants for Corinth. That's what any pastor wants for the church he's pastoring. As we grow in grace and grow in the Lord and in spiritual discernment, that we grow in love with one another and connected more and more to one another and committed more and more to the purpose, to the mission that God has given us while on this earth. He quotes Isaiah 40:13 there. But he says it again in Romans 11:34. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? As we leave today, I want us to go with this commitment. Dear God, this week, I don't want to inflict myself into a matter. I don't want to inflict my thoughts onto someone. Dear God, more than anything else this week, I want to have your mind on the matter. More than anything else this week, I want your word to grip me and capture me. I want it to be the lamp unto my feet, the light unto my path. I want this word hidden in my heart so it will challenge and shape my sanctification that I might not sin against you. Lord, I don't want the words I share this week to be my words because they will just be chaff that'll fall away. But, oh, dear God, make my words your words because your word doesn't return void. Your word always accomplishes the purpose with which it goes forth when it goes out of your mouth. Do you understand the mystery of the wisdom of God? Do you see the beauty of it? Christ, scorned, hated, reviled, reproached, rejected, crucified, buried, raised. The mystery of how God makes sinners right with him. The world will not take it and embrace it on face value. Don't expect them to. But you keep on sharing it. You keep on living it. You keep on shining that light of truth. And God will, in his time, open blinded eyes And one by one, people you pray for, one by one, people you encounter, one by one, people with whom you witness will say, I think I see it. I think I see it. Let's pray. Dear Holy Father, you're the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and we come and bow before you today in Jesus' name. And we are thankful. You could have left us in the dark. We could be groping around today, not knowing what we're doing and saying some of the most outlandish things and calling them wise. And we know this, Lord, because we see people every day in various arenas whom the world considers wise, who say some of the stupidest things. And Lord, rather than me looking at them thinking, how can a person be so stupid, help me just look at that and say, dear God, oh, thank you that you didn't leave me in darkness. Thank you that someone loved me enough to share the gospel with me, to pray for me. Thank you that you attended that word, that you honored those prayers and you opened my eyes. Thank you that you didn't leave me the stubborn, hard-headed, arrogant teenager who thought I knew everything. Oh God, thank you for that. And we pray that we will be men and women and boys and girls who delight in sharing the light of the knowledge of the glory of God displayed in the face, the life of Jesus Christ. And pray that those who our hearts are burdened for today, that one by one, you'll be pleased to let us hear them say as we shine this light of truth, to hear them say, I think I see. And then to hear them say, oh yes, what a beautiful name the name of Jesus is. What a wonderful Savior he is. Give us, dear God, the desires of our hearts on this, and help us as we grow in your wisdom to grow in love with Jesus and with one another, more committed to your purpose that you have for us while you leave us on this earth. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.